Wow, what a fantastic day we've had. And we've been saving the best till last. Is that the wrong thing to say? We've been saving something adequate till last. I hope you guys are going to suffer through it. It's a hardship, I know. Liz Keogh is a good friend of mine, and I've had the pleasure of working with her on several projects. She's always got a range of really interesting things to say, and she thinks deeply about what we do as an industry and how we do it. You may know her best from her work on behavior-driven development, BDD, where she helped coin the phrase and do the initial groundwork in it and explain it to people. But I believe today there are Martians.
There are Martians.
Excellent. All right. Thank you, Liz.
Cheers. Just to get a feel for the room, hands up if you're a dev. Hands up if you're a tester. Hands up if you're a Martian. One or two. Okay, brilliant. Today what I want to do is I want to talk about the bugs we have inside our head, how to test our head, some common bugs that we find inside our heads, and some ideas for how to fix those bugs. I'm going to start by telling you a story about a bug in my head, because we all love sleeping, right? We really love sleeping. Who really loves it? When you wake up in the morning and you've had a great night and you feel really refreshed and fantastic. Yeah, this isn't a story about that. This is a story about a motorbike that went past my house a couple of years back. Very typical night. And I go, oh, what was that? And I'm awake. It's 3 a.m. And I'm looking around going, what woke me, what woke me? It was a motorbike. It's just a motorbike. But for some reason, I have to wake up for the motorbike. And after I've woken up, I know I'm not going to get back to sleep again. I'm going to be awake all night because I'm a light sleeper, right? So I'm going to show you how this bug starts. We start by observing data. This is how we learn everything. This is how we come to understand ourselves and believe things. Observing data, there's a lot going on. I was probably dreaming. I probably had sounds and visions going on in my head. I was breathing, had the breath going in and out. I've got my duvet wrapped warm around me. But for some reason, I decided to filter down to the sounds of the motorbike. I then make an assumption. I'm going to be awake all night now. I'm awake now, I'm going to be awake all night. And I come to a belief that I'm a light sleeper. So this is how we build beliefs. It's also how we learn. This act of coming to understand patterns, to come to abstractions and then apply them again and again and again, is how we learn. And when we learn something, when we understand that our model of something is correct, we get a little buzz, a little chemical buzz, makes us feel good. Strangely, learning that I'm a light sleeper and having that confirmed, which means that I understand that I'm a light sleeper, that gives me a little buzz, because, oh, look, I'm a light sleeper. There we go again. At least I understand myself well enough to know that I'm a light sleeper. It's also the way we learn in games. This is book Theory of Fun. When we play a game, we have a thing we learn. If you've ever played World of Warcraft, you start at a really low level, not too much to do, and you learn how to do it, and then you do some more tricky stuff, and you learn how to do that. And as you progress, you get more and more difficult challenges, but you're applying the things you've already learned, those abstractions, to those challenges. How many people here enjoy playing games? Wave your hands if you enjoy playing games. Wave your hands if you really hate playing games. Wave your hands if you haven't waved your hands yet. I shouldn't have mentioned sleeping, because I can see all of you in your chairs like this. It's obviously coming to the end of the day. Wake up! It's fun. Okay, I'm going to show you another bug. And this is one which has affected a huge number of people. And in fact, it's a fairly common bug that we all have. But a lot of people have this belief because of this bug. Okay, this is a place on Mars called Cydonia. Right? Can you see anything interesting in this picture? Might help if I zoom in. Okay. This is a little hill in Cydonia that appears to be carved into the shape of a face. So there's a lot of data to observe there. But a lot of people, as human beings, we see faces, we fix on faces. And we see that, and a lot of people went, oh, it's a face carved into Mars! Isn't that amazing? Oh my God! So they've already filtered to this data. They made the assumption that it's deliberately been made, because obviously that could never happen naturally. Conclusion? Well, somebody on Mars must have made it. And the belief? There are aliens on Mars. Martians exist. Martians exist on Mars. Now, at the time this was taken, people didn't really know an awful lot about Mars. Seen it through telescopes, but this was the first time that anything had actually photographed the surface of Mars. And there's a saying that we don't know what we don't know, right? It's second-order ignorance. There's a lot of stuff out there that's a mystery to us, and some stuff we don't even realise is a mystery. But it's actually worse than that. The first time we come across something, we frequently make up what we don't know. And the more interesting the story we can make up, the more likely we are to engage with that story and really believe it. Developers have a particular propensity for doing this. We take our code, we take our problem, and we're listening to the business person, and while the business person is still talking, we're already coding it in our heads. Right? We haven't got all the information, but meh, who needs all the information? We're very good at jumping to conclusions. I showed this to a developer. A dev asked me, basically, what's the difference between a dev's role and a tester's role? Why should we have testers on our team? I said, well, here you go. Scribbled this on a piece of paper. I said, what's in the middle? He goes, well, it's a three. I said, okay, put your tester hat on. Pretend you're a tester. Now what's in the middle? He says, well, there's nothing in the middle. What ought to be in the middle? I said, great, that's why you need testers. I showed it to a real tester and I said, well, obviously it's going to be a three, but we don't know what it is at the moment. And the tester, the genuine tester, went, might not be. Testers are evil, evil people. It doesn't matter what you do, they will break your patterns, they will break your code. Okay. So here's a scenario. This is a thing from BDD that we do, right? We start from a context. We have some events that happen and we generate an outcome. And we're looking for an outcome that ought to occur. Okay, so it's an example. Given Fred bought a microwave and the microwave cost £100, when we refund the microwave, then Fred should be refunded £100. And you can run this with a till app and check that it still works. There's a thing that I like to do with this. It's called context questioning. I ask myself, is there a context in which this event will generate a different outcome? Is there a context in which a face on Mars might really not actually be carved by aliens? Is there an additional context that we're missing? In 2006, the Mars orbiter, reconnaissance orbiter, went back to Cydonia again, particularly to photograph the face. That's how much controversy this thing had caused. They had to go and photograph the face if they were going to circle around Mars, right? This is what they saw. There's no face there. There's no face at all. How on earth did we come to believe that this was a face? Well, it helps if you understand the context in which people were starting. This is a picture which was made from one of the early telescopes of Mars. And as you can see, there are all these little straight lines on here. This is by a guy called Percival Lowell, but there was another guy called Schiaparelli, Italian guy. And in 1877, he saw the same thing. And he described them as canals. Now, in Italian, the word canal means just a channel. But as soon as you say canal in English, people have this idea that somebody made it. Somebody made these straight line things across Mars. That doesn't happen naturally. There must be Martians. So already we were primed. Earth was primed to think of life on Mars. It turns out that if you get particularly cheap telescopes, and they have little dark spots in your view, they flare. And if you have two of them, the flares will join up and it'll look like a straight line. There's nothing like this on Mars. There are no straight lines. It was just an artifact of the telescope. But even though it was discounted close to 100 years ago, I was still reading stories about the canals on Mars when I was a child. It's really hard to let go of interesting myths. So we were primed to look for Martians on Mars. This is a thing called confirmation bias, right? We've got this model, this idea in our heads. And what we do is we go and we look for things that support that model. We do it deliberately. When we find something that supports our model, we get that little chemical buzz. A little bit of serotonin, nice little endorphins, whoosh. I'm not sure what the chemical buzz really is, but it's something like that. Yeah? It makes you feel good. It's your body's way of saying, congratulations, you learned something, go do it again. Do that more. If we find out that we're wrong, it makes us feel a bit down. We get a different kind of buzz. It's not fun. This is why it's really, really hard to seek genuine feedback from people that's genuinely going to help you improve, because to do that, you have to listen to these messages that you might be wrong. You're opening yourself up for this nasty little chemical dose. So that's confirmation bias. That is one of the biases we suffer from. You've also seen apophenia, which is our tendency to see patterns in things where there is no pattern, and pareidolia, our tendency to see an image or a sound as significant, is part of that. But there's more. There's the actor-observer bias. That means that if I'm playing cards and I win, it's because I'm a really good card player. If you win, you were lucky. The Google effect. Did you know there was a confirmation bias named after a bias named after Google? This is our tendency to forget things when we know we can find them online. There's the illusion of control, the idea that we're in control of a situation even when we're not. Insensitivity to sample size, omission bias, oh my God, there are so many biases. 159, if you go to the list of cognitive biases on Wikipedia, that's how many I counted, I might be out by a bit, but there are 159. Our understanding of reality is so very, very far from what reality actually is. It's amazing we can even do science, right? Here's how it works. We observe the data. We filter the data. It's impossible for us to not filter data. There is simply too much going on at any time. If you actually look at what people are seeing at any point, it's a very, very small amount of the entire picture. Our brain pieces it together for us, and our brain will do really odd things. There's a video on YouTube that you can look at. I think if you'll find it if you look up ba, 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 da, da, da. It's of a person, and the sound is da, da, da. But the lips moving in the video, say, ba, ba, ba. Guess what you hear when you're watching the video? Ba, ba, ba. Go and have a look at it and give it a try. And you'll play it again, looking away, and it will very clearly sound like da, da, da. And then you look back and it's ba, ba, ba. It's really odd. Our brain does these really strange things. So we generate assumptions based on how we're filtering, and we're filtering using our biases. We draw conclusions and we build beliefs. Guess what beliefs give us? Biases with which to filter the data. So not only are we primed to go out and look for stuff that supports the models, we filter things using those models as well, reinforcing them even further and stopping us from going and looking for the stuff that will tell you any different? So I want you to imagine something for me now. I want you to imagine that it's 1938. And World War is on the brink. You're listening to the radio, you turn on CBS, and it's the news. You're listening to that familiar authoritative voice that you're used to, telling you about the events of the day, when suddenly the newscaster says, "We interrupt this program to bring you extraordinary news. We're getting reports of a spacecraft." Is that right? Yes, a spacecraft which has crashed in a park in London. There are reports of casualties. We don't have any details right now. And as the news continues, they bring in more and more reports. People being killed. Giant three-legged tripod machines walking across London. Reports of more spaceships spotted in the skies above the States. This is 1938, before anybody has photographed the surface of Mars. Can you imagine how that would make you feel, hearing your usual newscaster saying those things? There were panic across America. Absolute panic. Launched Orson Welles' career because he starred in the dramas that followed. But absolute panic and riot. When I was a child, I heard reports that one woman had committed suicide rather than be taken by the Martians. It caused such a controversy that they swore they would never do it again. It was obviously far too easy for people to believe that there really were Martians coming. So never, never again. So in 1949 in Spain, they did it again in Spanish. Six people were killed in those riots. Our non-existent Martians have killed people. That's how strong our beliefs are. I really like to break beliefs. I particularly like to do it with code. Here's how we normally carry on our work, or traditionally, right? I'm a dev. Here's how I would love code to work. I make my code, I give it to some testers, bingo, off it goes to production. Yay! Did I mention that testers are really evil people? Right? Testers have these things called deliberate discovery skills, the skills to deliberately discover problems in my code. Hands up, the testers. Oh, look, they're a little bit hesitant now. Don't worry, you're safe. It doesn't make it to production. It frequently has rework. And the rework comes back in the form of bugs, and bugs aren't very good. We don't like bugs. Bugs tell us that our model was wrong. Bugs make me as a dev feel bad. And the reason I'm into behavior-driven development is so that I can put the testers first. We have the conversations with the testers, who can use their evil, deliberate discovery skills before I've written anything. You can tell me what bugs you're going to find, and I go, ah, but you won't find those anymore because now I'm going to code them out. I'm going to make sure that they don't get to you afterwards. And it results in less rework. Oh, if only it resulted in no rework at all. Do you remember that thing about we don't know what we don't know? There's frequently rework anyway. And testers frequently find the rework for me because they're evil. So we've seen context questioning. Is there a context which will generate a different outcome? I bet you, if you had taken a tester and said, hey, what do you think the outcome will be if we run this program and pretend Martians have invaded the Earth? They would have gone, is that the only outcome that matters? That you get your ratings, you get your advertising, you get your money? Could anything else possibly go wrong? Like people genuinely believing they were being invaded by Martians? But they didn't do that. They didn't think about that. They didn't even try it with a small group of people first. They went out and they did it. Twice. Those of you who followed my work will know I'm into something quite heavily called real options. Real options says having choices is valuable. Options have value. Options expire. At some point, you lose the ability to make a choice. And the most important bit, never commit early unless you know why. That means if you're going to do something new and unusual, you might want to try it somewhere safe first. You might want to get some information about what it is you're doing before you try it out. Now, when we do it with code, it's actually fairly easy to get the information before we make the commitment of implementing. We can talk to people. You get the tester in, you also get the business expert in, who can answer the questions that devs and the tester have. But there's a problem when it comes to beliefs. Beliefs are really, really tricky to change. We've reinforced them. We've usually gone out and found things that will reinforce our beliefs. The most flawed commitments we make are the ones in our own heads. We've already decided that something is true, and we go off, we code the thing without doing the questions. We decide that Martians really exist without actually going and searching for evidence. So I have a third type of questioning that I use for real-life situations, not code. Is there a different context which might have produced this outcome? Do you know what the most crazy thing is? I went to Google Face on Mars because I remembered Cydonia. I remembered that there was a face in Cydonia. The images are not of the face in Cydonia. There are more faces that they're claiming have been carved by Martians. People on the internet are claiming that Martians still exist, that they've carved these other faces they keep finding. People on the internet are wrong. Turns out so are we. I'm going to introduce you to something I absolutely love. It's called Project Implicit. If you search for it, you'll find their website. They've got this lovely, lovely quote on Project Implicit to talk about what it does. Every man has reminiscences which he would not tell to everyone, but only to his friends. He has other matters in his mind which he would not reveal even to his friends, but only to himself, and that in secret. But there are other things which man is afraid to tell even to himself, and every decent man has a number of such things stored away in his mind. There are things that we hide from ourselves. This is what Project Implicit does. It gives you a pair of concepts. So in this case, we are looking at family versus career and male versus female. And it gives you something which relates to each of those concepts. So in this case, an office relates to a career. It gives you girls or men's names. It gives you stuff to do with family, weddings, babies, whatever. And you have to put your fingers on a keyboard and say which side the word goes on, as quickly as you can. And then they swap the associations and do it again. If you are the kind of person who thinks of mostly men at work and mostly women at home, you will find it easier to pair the words, to match the words, when the woman is paired with family and the man is paired with the career. And they can time this. And they can tell you how strong your association is. They've got it for race. They've got it for preferences of white and black faces. They've got it for associations of violence with race. So you can see whether a word is peaceful or violent and associate it with white or black. A white and black face. It's a project designed to help us uncover our hidden biases. I highly recommend, if you are worried that you have some bias, maybe you think you might be a bit racist, You don't really want to be, but sometimes our culture can bring us up that way. It turns out I'm not racist, but I'm ageist. I had, maybe I still do, an inclination that tells me that old people are sick and not very useful. I've tried to counter it by hanging around amazing older people that I know and discovered some new role models in the process. It's been quite an experience. So please, go, try it out. Stereotyping is only one of the beliefs that we come up with. Here's one of my saddest beliefs that I've ever seen. It's from a film called Precious. Has anybody seen Precious? A few people. It's about a black girl, very poor neighbourhood. She's 15. She's pregnant with her second child by her stepfather who's died. And she says in the film, "Nobody loves me." And she genuinely believes this. Nobody loves me. Fortunately, she has a very lovely teacher who says to her, "That's not true, Precious. I love you. Your baby loves you." Her teacher is able to give her examples which break her model. And because she's found the examples which break that model, she can start to debug her mind. Another one I've frequently heard: nothing goes right on this project. What, nothing? Absolutely nothing? It's what we call an absolutism: nothing, nobody. Yeah. Really? You can't even write code? Run tests? Ship something, maybe? And my absolute favourite, which I hear all the time at conferences: I'm no good at remembering names. Isn't that an interesting belief? Do you know why teams of 8 to 12 people work so well? It's because historically our ancestors came from little groups of 8 to 12 people. We only had to remember 8 to 12 names. Maybe we knew a couple of the other people from neighbouring tribes who came to trade or whatever, but really, not many. We didn't have to remember many names. Now we remember our names, our family's names, our extended family's names, our friends' names, people we meet at conferences, people we know from work, other people we know from work, people we used to know from our previous work. Oh my God, we're amazing at remembering names. We're flipping phenomenal at remembering names. There's just an awful lot of people. It's okay. So I asked myself the question, what if that wasn't true? What if the complete opposite was true? What if we were amazing at remembering names? It turns out that when I start telling myself, I can remember names. I'm learning to remember names even better. Lo and behold, my brain starts going, oh, that must be important then. Well, I'll help you remember those names. And I can remember names. I do occasionally forget people's names. There's a lot of people. But I'm much, much better now that I've stopped telling myself I can't remember names. I'm no good at remembering names. Every human being in this room is brilliant at remembering names. Not so sure about the Martians. So I want to introduce you just to close with something that I've seen from hypnotherapy. So I've been training as a hypnotherapist. There's this guy, Emil Keogh, very famous hypnotherapist. And he says, what you need to do is tell yourself over and over again, auto-suggestion, how good you are at doing stuff, how much better you're becoming. And it's not Alan Partridge, I'm a tiger, rah. Yeah? Although, you know, if it works for you, go for it. He has this little mantra: every day, in every way, I get better and better. Every day, in every way, I get better and better. Of course, he does it in French. But just say it to yourself. Doesn't that feel good? We do love sleeping, don't we? I did a little bit of hypnotherapy myself. I took on some beliefs that I wanted to change, and one of them was this belief that I was a light sleeper. Turns out I'm not a light sleeper. I'm a deep sleeper. I'm a deep sleeper. I wake if I feel like I need to for a sound. I have no problem getting back to sleep again. I sleep really well, really soundly, have the most fantastic dreams, and wake up feeling refreshed. The only reason I didn't was because I worried about being a light sleeper all the time. Changing that belief has allowed it to become true, has allowed the fact that I really am a deep sleeper, a sound sleeper, somebody who can feel really refreshed after a night's sleep. That's now true for me. I can change my beliefs if I want to, and so can all of you. Thank you. Any questions? Yep, please shout.
So, how do you deal with the immediate reaction that if I know myself, I'm getting better and better at everything? My immediate reaction there is that, well, that's objectively not true.
Now, what if that wasn't true? What if that wasn't true? You got worse at absolutely everything? That's amazing. I can't get worse at everything, even if I try.
I got worse at one thing.
You got worse at one thing?
Yeah.
Okay, so you didn't get better in one way.
Yeah.
Do you see how he filters the data already? It's brilliant. If you ignore that and filter it out and ignore it, because your model will be that in every way you're getting better and better. You won't see it because you're filtering for something different. That's the idea of this. So by holding this belief that you're really good, you start looking for evidence that you're really good. And the stronger you go looking for that evidence and ignoring the stuff that doesn't support that model, the more likely that belief is to happen and for it to become true. There's another phrase I love, chance favors the prepared mind. And it's the case that an optimist, somebody who expects to be lucky, will be preparing for that luck and will be ready for that luck and will notice that luck when it happens, whereas a pessimist won't. There's a saying that optimists are also opportunists, and there's not really a lot of difference between them. A pessimist always thinks the glass is half empty, an optimist thinks the glass is half full, and an opportunist drinks the beer, right? Any more questions?
Yeah, I have a question around filtering the data. Is it not risky? I mean, you have a model which you believe is right, and if there is any data set that you get which is outside that model, then rather than thinking that, okay, my model might be wrong, if you filter that data, then would it not be risky? For example, if we have a test and 99 things are passing on test, one is failing, it's a defect. We can't just filter it out.
Well, here's the weird thing. If you want to fix stuff, you need to spot what's wrong and fix it, except with your head. If with your head, we found that actually focusing on the negative stuff is not as useful. Who here has done performance reviews where you had to address your weaknesses? Anyone? Is there anyone who's done a performance review where they worked out what your strengths were and actually got you to play on your strengths and said, don't worry about your weaknesses because, you know, the rest of your team will look after those? It turns out that playing on our strengths is far, far more effective. So I don't see my weaknesses as a bug anymore as such. I see them as a thing that I'm going to get other people to help me with. So I don't think it's necessarily useful to focus on them. I don't think it's necessarily useful to focus on what you can't do. Focus on what you can do and the fact that you're getting better at it, including remembering people's names, yeah? Because we are actually good at that. Does that...
Just a follow-on thing. I mean, focusing on and acknowledging, are they not different? I mean, you can still acknowledge that, okay, there is a problem in my model, and you can still not be focused or get obsessed about it.
Yeah, you can acknowledge it. I'm really bad at estimates. I'm just not worried about that.
Yeah, that works.
I also hate estimating. I think it's pointless. I'm fairly well known for my rants about estimates. But as a result, I get other people on my team to do estimates and dodge out of them whenever I can. I also really hate planning meetings, sitting for 2 hours while you estimate everything and play planning poker. And yeah, so other people can do that for me. Any other questions? Someone at the back?
How do you do all that stuff in teams?
How do you
avoid cognitive biases in teams? How do you teach teams to avoid those cognitive biases?
How do I teach teams to avoid cognitive biases? I actually run a feedback workshop so that people can give each other feedback. And one of the techniques I use for feedback is anchor the things you value and work out what it is you want, a bright future, and tell a story about that bright future to them. I used to do the sandwich model where you put something in the middle about what's going wrong, and I don't do that anymore. I found that actually just talking to people about what your goals are and the shared goals you'd like to have is enough that they'll change. So I teach people how to do that. I also make them aware of, say, body language. But I'll say I had one guy who was very, very stressed. And obviously had a lot on his plate, and he went into an interview, and he came out of the interview, he said, oh, that guy's no good, he's just nervous as anything. And I'm looking at him, and this guy's like almost shaking with the caffeine, you know, and he's like this, and he's really intense. I'm like, dude, yeah, I'd be nervous facing you like this. Do you want to loosen up? Want to, you know, go get a cup of peppermint tea, maybe, something with that less caffeine in? That'd be great. You can make people aware of their body language, and then they become aware of that. There's a thing you can do, I can't remember what it's called, but where you notice when you're doing something and you make a big stop sign in your head and then move to the better thing immediately, as quickly as you can. And that can help to reinforce the good stuff as well. You may have noticed earlier when I was drinking, my hands are shaking quite badly. Right, I actually get really nervous doing this every single time, despite the fact that I've done it 100 times. It's, for some reason, a belief I haven't really addressed yet. Maybe I don't get nervous, I just think I do. But I don't notice because I'm really enjoying the talking. I don't actually notice that I'm nervous. I don't know whether that makes sense to you guys. Are there any other questions?
Just the last one. I mean, how do you incorporate all these biases and all this knowledge around this into the work, like the practical?
How do you incorporate all the knowledge about this? You become a psychologist or a hypnotherapist, or you do something professionally. And I think Malcolm Gladwell talks about 10,000 hours of expertise. So yeah, I don't think you can, but I think you can. You can if you want to do it properly, long term. But even the little bit of knowledge that I've had, even a little bit of study around the subject has really helped me. Really helped me a lot. I honestly wouldn't be on this stage talking to you if I hadn't looked at some of this stuff. So deciding I was a good speaker and would become a better speaker is how I can do this. Is it helpful? You're all looking like, where's the beer? Okay. Any other questions? All right. Enjoy yourselves. See you back here tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Liz. You finished on time. This is amazing. I've very rarely gone to a conference where things have run on time. Thank you to all the speakers today who have helped make that happen. Thank you to Liz for that fantastic keynote. I enjoyed it an awful lot. Liz said you were wondering where the beer was. Is that right? I hear a couple of people. If you take a look in the program for today, you'll see that it's at the Glasshouse Stores. Not all of you may know London as well as I do. The Glasshouse Stores are number 55 Brewer Street. The nearest tube station is Piccadilly Circus. It's about a 20-minute walk away from here at a sort of gentle amble. The party will be starting off at 6 o'clock, and I should really say thank you to our friends at Facebook for helping to sponsor that party. So I don't know where you guys are, but if you want to raise your hand, I'm sure people will give you a clap. Can you go now? Was that... Yeah. Wow, you're keen. I mean, it's a pub, right? They're not going to say, no, we're not serving you a drink. they might say that to you, but... I could ad-lib now for a... No, okay, brilliant. All right. Well, the other thing as well is it's not a good idea to leave any stuff behind in the venue tonight. There's going to be another group in. So if you leave something here tonight, it may not be here in the morning. So take it with you and try not to lose it in a drunken stupor as you leave the Glasshouse Stores tonight. Thank you all so much, and I will see you all tomorrow.